Hi everyone, welcome to the session Stepping Towards Big Data Now. Myself Vinay Kumar, working in Huawei, and so let's start. Yeah, this is me. Working in Huawei as a lead architect in India and Bangalore, and I've been with Apache for a long time actually. A project management committee member and committer in Apache Hadoop and incubator. So in incubator I'm mentoring one of the project, and totally 10 years, 10 plus years on work on Hadoop and related work, especially in HDFS, because since I'm a committer and will know end-to-end about the Hadoop, and so I work on related technologies. So you can catch me on this mail IDs and Twitter and LinkedIn as well. Okay, so this is about today's agenda, and first we'll see a little bit about ARM, and so we'll get to know about how ARM works and what are the areas it covers and why we are talking about it today. So next is on big data on ARM. So obviously we are in big data track and we need to talk about big data, and so let's talk about big data in ARM platform. And Hadoop on ARM, so Hadoop is basically one of the fundamental component of any big data deployments. So when we talk about supporting big data now, definitely we should talk about Hadoop support on ARM. So we'll talk about that there in Hadoop on ARM. And after that, we'll check some of the results of running Hadoop on ARM. And so after that, we'll focus on some of the what are the future goals. So what we should do after this. And then we'll get back to our comments who have contributed to this work. So first is background about ARM. So we know all these things. So here are some of the images of famous smartphone processors. First one is Qualcomm, second one is Samsung Exynos processor, third one is Apple A13 Bionic processor, Kirin 990 from Huawei, MediaTek from MediaTek. So all these are smartphone processors that we know. What is common among all these chips? So common is all are ARM powered. So what is ARM? Basically, ARM is a processor, CPU designed by advanced RISC. Before this, it was Acorn RISC machines, and which was spinned out, advanced RISC machines spinned out from Acorn RISC machines in 1990. So ARM is based on RISC architecture, reduced instruction set computers architecture, and it supports a limited number of instruction sets targeted for a particular application category. I will get to know about that, what is that particular application category, in coming slides. ARM company, the ARM technologies itself will not manufacture any silicon chips. So in previous slide, we have seen different smartphone chips from different companies. All are powered by ARM. So ARM company itself will not manufacture silicon chips. It doesn't fabricate the chips, but instead it invests itself in designing the chips and licenses those designs to these partners. They call it this other manufacturers of the silicon chips as partners. And the partners will enhance that design. They will embed their own components inside that processor for optimal performance and all. And they will then manufacture the chips for their usage. So as we see, ARM devices are everywhere, all around us. So starting from smartphones, wearables, everyone will have smartwatch, hard disks, SSD. Even hard disks are SSD also powered by ARM. I'll explain how those are powered. Smart cars, now the upcoming trend is smart car, IoT, everywhere it is there. And smart home, smart city, drones, robotics, healthcare. This is interesting, the Raspberry Pi. So we have seen many interesting things going on using Raspberry Pis. So that is also powered by ARM. The processor inside Raspberry Pi is one of the ARM processor, and data centers are server machines. So this is upcoming trend where ARM has recently entered the data center market or server business. So we have already have some of the server boards in ARM, and not the least, this is upcoming. It's not just to make a point, I have added as MacBook Pro, but there are already laptops which are based on ARM, like from Microsoft Surface. I have one. So we will be seeing ARM everywhere around us. We are seeing and will be continuously seeing ARM process everywhere. And so the today's fastest supercomputer, Fugaku by Fujitsu Japan, is also based on ARM version 8.0 architecture, which is 64-bit architecture. And this have 150,976 A64FX CPUs done together. So A64FX is the CPU designed by Fujitsu itself, which is also having the ARM architecture. As I mentioned, it is 8.2 64-bit architecture. So such chips are connected together. So like more than 150,000 chips are connected together to make this supercomputer. And that has been used for the recent pandemic research. And it has, this supercomputer has won many of the awards recently. And that fastest is being one of them. Okay, now we have seen the areas where ARM is available today. So we have seen everywhere around us, but how can a same design of ARM or same one processor can cover most of those many areas? Actually, it is not one design. ARM provides wide range of processor designs, though everything is like based on RISC architecture. So there are different profiles. So they call it as profiles. Cortex-A, Cortex-R, and Cortex-M. These are the profile ranges ARM calls. So Cortex-A is the range for like whatever we are seeing in the smartphones or laptops or like digital TVs, what is like high performance range. So Cortex-R is the real-time needs, where some complex storage solutions like SSD, all those things will need Cortex-R design, where real-time need is more. And Cortex-M is for the microcontroller chips or embedded devices, so like IoT devices or many more. So all the embedded devices will go for the Cortex-M architecture. So in each and every profile, the instruction set it offers is different. And so each instruction set have its own like advantages and its own purpose. So all those things, so whichever range, whichever profile a partner needs to go or a device needs to be made, the corresponding profile design will be licensed from ARM to that partner. Okay, basically ARM design, like from the beginning, whenever they started in 1990, from that point of onwards, their design basically targeted towards power consumption and thermal footprint. Power consumption in the sense, less power consumption. So power efficiency in power consumption and less thermal footprint. So it should not get heated too much and reduce the performance of the processor. So this is one of the like, not one of the, this is the major focus for their designs and which is an important factor for consumer devices, like our smartphones or any of the small devices, whatever we see today. So all this needs these factors. So if smartphone is getting heated up, it will get slower. So those are the things which are important factor, and that is why ARM is like widely used in all these areas. So RISC, as I mentioned, reduced instruction set computer design makes it possible to keep the ARM core size small, and single processor can house more number of cores. So ARM is basically about more number of cores compared to x86 or CISC based designs. x86 is based on CISC based designs. CISC is complex instruction set computers. So CISC is mainly targeting towards the performance rather than power consumption and thermal footprint. So because of its less number of instruction sets, core size will be small, and there will be in a single chip, there can be very like more number of cores housed. And the execution model of the ARM is like scale out execution, not the scale up execution. Scale out means like they have more number of cores, and the work will be distributed among multiple cores. So if it work cannot be distributed, say suppose if you have 100 cores in a board and 100 cores may not be required to be used, say only 50 used, next 50 can be powered off or may not may be kept in less power, and that will bring up the more power efficiency out of ARM processor. Scale up execution is from the x86 CISC based designs, where the capacity of one core is higher, but even though the entire capacity is not used, but the entire CPU needs to be powered up. So that is where the power consumption will be more for x86 processors. So SoC designs, SoC is a system on chip. As I mentioned, ARM will license it out that design to partners, and partners will enhance the design. Along with core, they will embed some other devices or some other components inside a single processor, like GPU or some other fast memory, faster memory. All those things they can embed within a single chip. So, and finally, it will come out as a system on chip. The entire system will be on a single chip. So those designs will be customized by individual partners or individual manufacturer of the chip. And so because of that, it will enhance its own the particular chip's performance and efficiency and thermal footprint. So we have talked about only the ARM usage in the smartphone or like smaller devices area, but until recently, ARM entire design was only 32-bit. It was not supporting the 64-bit, which is very important for server market or the bigger data market. So from ARM version 8, the 64-bit, also called as ARC64, is designed, and based on that, ARM has officially entered the server market. So there are many support available from the software vendors, like OS vendors are already stepped in, like Windows released its OS based on ARM and IoT for the IoT sector, and many Linux-based flavors like Ubuntu, Fedora, CentOS, many are available for ARM platform. Directly you can install. It is available. No need to do any of the tweaks. So most of the softwares, like other than OS, other softwares also are being ported and optimized for ARM platform. So because of the ARM power, focus on power efficiency and thermal footprint, the cost and maintenance of the ARM servers are cheaper. So as I mentioned earlier, ARM designs are focused on power consumption and thermal footprint. So in a data center, it's very important to keep the entire data center cooler as much as possible. It's cool as much as possible. For that, you need to have a lot of electricity going on to be used. So that is where maintenance cost will be higher for x86. And that is why the end customer has to pay most of that. Not, that means end customer has to bear all those expenses. But in ARM servers, since the thermal footprint is less and the power efficiency is good, the end maintenance will be less, and so that will reduce the end user cost. So these are some of the already server chips available. AMD also generates x86, and as well as it has recently released ARM-based servers. So Kunpeng 920 is one of the server processor based on ARM from Huawei, and Ampere is one of the major server processor provider based on ARM, and AWS Graviton processor is in-house built processor based on ARM 64-bit design, which is based on which the ARM instances are available in the AWS as well. Okay, so now we talked about background about the ARM and its importance in the server market. So now we'll talk about the big data. So when we come to big data, so current deployment all are focusing on x86, and there might be very less number of big data deployments on ARM. But before that, we'll just discuss about what is the overview. So current big data deployments will majorly might involve most of the Apache projects, starting with Hadoop, Spark, for the resource management, and Spark for distributed query processing and all. So all these are built for, Hadoop became famous in the beginning stages because it started to work on commodity hardware. Commodity hardware means whatever we have, the normal laptops, normal PCs and all. It doesn't need specialized hardware for that. So to support commodity hardware, but production workloads cannot run on them. It needs the powerful capable machines, which is like server machines, the data center machines. So that will make the deployments costlier, so high operating cost. So this is the current state of the big data clusters. The pros of x86 based clusters is like as like, of course, it is performance throughput per node because x86 concentrates more on performance, and so it will get out of the it will get the maximum performance out of it, and stable software support. So x86 designs are there from long time in the server business, and accordingly, all the software is required to run the production clusters in server modes are there. Everything is stable. All the OS providers are having stable support. All the open source ecosystem, all big data, whatever I mentioned here, Hadoop, Spark, all those things are providing stable support for the x86 based cluster. So cons of x86 is basically the entire thing is the money. So a large number of nodes required because we need to have big data. Basically means big like large amount of data, and for that that much amount of data to process, you need more number of nodes. More number of nodes means you need to spend more money. And so another like point is carbon footprint from this cooling systems of the data center is more here because of the higher thermal footprint from the x86 and more power consumption as well. So now before entering into ARM platform, before discussing about the big data on ARM, we need to have some mechanisms to evaluate so whether our big data workloads will be good on ARM or not. So one can say that you can directly come like the how we spin out the same number of nodes in ARM and whether you can test directly the performance. That is one way. So we'll talk about another way here, cost performance model. So what is about cost performance model? So here, before that, the selling point of ARM, unique selling point of ARM servers, as I discussed, it is everything is about money. So here are the examples are from different cloud vendors. The same ARM servers from Huawei Cloud and x86, the same configuration, 16 core and 64 GB memory will be will be saving 41% compared to x86. The same with AWS also, it will save 20%. And in packet cloud, it will save 50%, but because x86 have a higher memory, it doesn't have the same variant in both the x86 and ARM. It will save 50% of the memory. But the challenges are, like as I mentioned here, this is just one of the example. Here, difference in frequency. If you get the same variant, the CPU frequencies will be different. It can be different. We cannot compare the performance directly. It's not apple to apple comparison. So memory differences, as we have seen, this variant, packets.com variant is, x86 variant have more memory than x86. Numerical arrangement differences internally, different core arrangements will be different, and scheduler differences, since scheduler differences comes in kernel, OS kernels, so that might have different differences based on the stability of the kernel for different architecture. And finding a comparable configurations, as we mentioned, it might be very difficult to find, make the comparisons between two different variants of comparisons. So this is like, even though cost is cheaper, but we cannot go directly with it because based on the actual design, ARM will perform lesser compared to x86 because it is risk-based. In some use cases, some workloads, for example, I have seen one paper where ARM seems to be performing better on integer workloads, the same configuration, same processor frequency, same memory, everything same. So ARM seems to be performing better on integer-based workloads than x86, but it lags behind in floating point-based workloads. So like that, different workloads may differ in different architecture. So, but to match with all our workload, we need to have one of the model, and that is a cost-based performance, where we need to keep the cost as constant. Say, I have this much of budget. Let's see how much return on that budget a customer can get, throughput per a dollar spent. So here is the example, budget is $8, And option one is M ARM resources. Option two is N x86 resources. Obviously, ARM is cheaper than N. I mean, ARM is cheaper than x86, so we'll get more ARM resources here. So with having more number of ARM resources, can we get more throughput than x86? So if even if you get little improvement also, little more throughput also in ARM, so that will be a cost saving for the end customer or the user who is going to deploy the big data on ARM. So the definition of this cost model is given the on-par cost of both the resources, can we exploit the ARM variant to its fullest benefit and get better performance when compared to x86? So this cost performance model was conceptualized by one of our colleague Krunal, and we can go through this MySQL on ARM and GitHub.io. He is working on running MySQL on ARM deployments. So he came up with this cost performance model. So next, we'll just take one example where we'll have some $3,500 per year on Huawei Cloud, and where x86 we can get, this is using the same cost, which variant we can get. So x86 we can get 12 core 48 GB, which is costing around $3,400, and ARM will get 24 core 48 GB. So here we'll get memory same, but we'll get double cores. So that is 2x double core. So ARM is having 3 gigahertz processor, and x86 having 3 gigahertz processor, and ARM is having 2.6 gigahertz, which is Kunpeng based processor. So here, almost double gigahertz we are getting in computing power. But whether that means 2x core means whether the total throughput will be 2 times, definitely no. But it depends on workload. As I mentioned, different workloads might result in different performance in different architecture. Okay, so even with this much, even though we are getting more resources on ARM, why not everyone are deploying on ARM? Because not much of server options are available on ARM, because if you see ARM instance in AWS cloud, there are only less models to choose. Recently it is coming, but in earlier days it is very less. And open source big data ecosystem, whatever we discussed, Hadoop, Spark, were not supporting on ARM platform until recently. And vendors, already these things are tried out, deploying a big data or Hadoop or Spark on ARM, and they tried out for the experiment purpose, but that had involved a lot of code changes internally. And they had to go to internals of each and every component used, and they need to tweak a lot of code. That was a painful process. So if vendors are supporting, say suppose one of the vendor, big data vendor, is supporting their distribution on, that means they have a lot of internal to support on ARM, and they may face difficulty in keeping up with the open source changes because of the private changes. So why users, another thing is users don't risk deployments because of all these big factors, like unavailability of the software support, software or even hardware support, also because this server business is just now started. Just now in the sense, last decade it has started. Hadoop on ARM. So Hadoop on ARM, when we came to Hadoop on when we are discussing about Hadoop on ARM, Hadoop is one of the base component of big data deployments. So all the big data distributions or big data deployments really got popular when Hadoop came into picture, because it was open source, free, and it was able to run on commodity hardware, where users can test their deployments on commodity hardware. Then they can move on to the actual deployments, where we need to get the they need to go to any of the data center or any cloud vendor or like that. So many other components also depends on Hadoop for compilation. For example, we call big data or Hadoop big data as the ecosystem, where there are many components which depends on each other. So Hadoop is one of the dependency on which many other components depends. For example, Hive, Spark, or all the big data components, most of them will depend on Hadoop even for compilation. But Hadoop doesn't even compile on ARM until last release, which is 3.3.0. So what, as I mentioned, many attempts were already done to compile on ARM and on Hadoop on ARM, so which involved a lot of fix. So what were the challenges for Hadoop to support or not. So one of the biggest challenges was protobuf, where protobuf 2.5.0 was not actually supporting ARM, and it was doesn't have distribution for ARM. And there were other, many other third-party libraries which involved some native code, like packaged inside that jar, but there was no support for ARM-based platform. And there was no ARM resources to run a CA in open source. I'm not talking about only Apache. There were many other communities also which where CA is mostly runs on x86 resources. So that might be one of the factor where open source communities may not support or may not think about supporting an ARM. So why protobuf was a challenge? Because Hadoop is mainly a backward compatible component where it concentrates more of its efforts on backward compatibility. And so it don't want to break any of the downstream. As I said, Hadoop is one of the major dependency for many of the other projects. So when Hadoop breaks, the usage or adoption of the newest version of Hadoop will be very less. So, but protobuf is not so popular in maintaining the backward compatibility. So that is why the Hadoop stood on protobuf 2.5.0 for a long time, because it had a bad experience in upgrading from previous version to 2.5.0, and many of the other downstream projects had broken. So that is why and also downstream projects uses Hadoop RPC. Hadoop RPC is a mechanism to communicate between a client and server. Many of the downstream projects implement their own RPC, but protobuf is the center of that RPC. So protobuf is used for serializing that RPC request from client to server. So if protobuf breaks, RPC will break. So that is where the protobuf was an upgrade challenge, and so that the Jira to upgrade the protobuf was there from almost 3-4 years. It was not progressed after that. So how protobuf was upgraded? So HBase, we got inspired from one of the HBase, the way of upgrade. HBase had created one of the sub project called HBase sub repository, which is HBase third party, where it had shaded all the dependencies which have, which will break the compatibility on upgrade. All those libraries they put inside this repo, and they shaded, they relocated the classes from original classes to their own package name. Similarly, we followed in Hadoop, where we shaded the protobuf 3.7.1. We took the latest version of protobuf 3.7.1 at that time, and we shaded that and relocated the different package thanks to shared plugin, Maven shared plugin. And we used that shaded version of protobuf inside every usage within our Hadoop. And so how we replaced all the existing usage, because thousands of classes, thousands of files were there, we used a replacer plugin thanks to that. And also one of the pain point was the compiling Hadoop was expecting to compile Hadoop, the protobuf installation, protobuf executable installation has to be done on the compile machine. But that was a pain point where some users will have Ubuntu 18, where latest version of protobuf will be 3.x. It was not 2.5 or something before. So that was a pain point. Now we are supporting the dynamic resolution of protobuf executable, where a single machine, irrespective of the version, can compile a different version of protobuf as well. So that also has been improved in this thanks to protobuf Maven plugin, where it will dynamically find out the protobuf executable, and it uses that to generate classes. So along with that, all the exposed APIs which contains protobuf in signature was removed. Luckily, only one was there, which is not part of the public APIs, and nobody was using that. So latest clients outside of Hadoop. Say, suppose, as I mentioned, already there are many other ecosystem projects which depends on Hadoop, and they also stood on protobuf 2.5.0 because Hadoop is using 2.5.0. They cannot use the other version of protobuf. Now, if they want to improve or implement their own version of RPC based on Hadoop 3 version, or protobuf 3 version, then they can use the Hadoop third-party jar in their dependency, and they can use the protobuf RPC engine 2 to register their protocol. So kept the existing version of protobuf RPC engine, we kept as it is to support the existing clients, which I have already using the 2.5.0 of protobuf. And so this is still there. So both version of protobuf coexist in a single Hadoop, and both version of clients, which like clients RPC, will be supported. And another transit dependency of protobuf is 2.5.0 still, because to maintain the backward compatibility. And for the downstream projects, or any of the projects which wants to use their own protobuf, they can just exclude this transitive dependency in their Maven dependency section, and they can go ahead with their own protobuf. And so as I mentioned, resources was not there in the, so here the upgrade was complete and Hadoop was able to compile and all, tests started running, and we need to build a CI on this. So there were no earlier ARM resources available in Apache Jenkins. So Huawei had contributed ARM VMs along with OpenLab, and it has been integrated to Apache Jenkins, and we have created on ARM job in ARM Jenkins, Apache Jenkins, and that is running 24,000 tests every day. And as I mentioned, some third-party libraries were also depending on, were not supporting ARM, but there were no community support for this. For example, LevelDB community is retired, and there was no latest jars available in this, which is actually having the native code in that. So we had to rebuild the LevelDB, and we published it under OpenLab, and that has been used in Hadoop ARM build. And another library was protobuf jrpc java, which is upgraded to latest version, which officially supports ARM. And Netty is another library where there was no existing release which supports ARM, or there were some failures with that release on ARM. We, along with OpenLab, our colleagues contributed patch to that Netty community and got that released in next version. And we upgraded to the next version of Netty with ARM support in Hadoop. And then we went ahead with the Hadoop release, which is 3.3.0, which officially supports ARM. So for the tryout purpose, official binary for the R64 version is also available. So user can try out and run their workloads on ARM. So we had tested and we verified this cost performance model, what we discussed earlier. We created some 3-node cluster with the same cost, both are same cost. x86 was 8 core and 12 GB, and ARM was 12 core and 18 GB, three machines each. We ran TerraSort for 58 GB data and with a different compression codecs. So Z-Standard is the best among them. In both the versions of platform, Z-Standard performed better. And so basically, when you compare, almost the performance is better in ARM cluster, because ARM resources are more here, but the cost remains the same. So another test, we did test DFSIO on the same environment, where write of 1K files we did with 10 MB each, reads of 1K files with 1 MB each, read 10K files with 1 MB. Here also results are pretty much same. Like we almost got 10% improvement in the both workloads. I mentioned only TerraSort, but we got both throughput more than, means around 10% in 10 to 11% in both the workloads. So this proves our point, like cost performance, proves the cost performance model, whatever we discussed earlier. Like with the same cost cluster, so ARM cluster means the same cost with the same budget, ARM cluster performs better by 10%. So the future scope is like, now we support ARM for compilation or running, but we need to optimize ARM. So we are still in this result, we are still seeing some of the improvement points where the compression libraries are the some of the bottlenecks, where it really performs bad when we compare against the same configuration clusters. Say, for example, the same number of cores and memory in keeping both x86 and ARM, then compression libraries are the one which are bringing down the performance in ARM. So like that, maybe some other points might be there we need to focus on. Like that, we need to optimize more things, optimize for the better performance in ARM ecosystems. So this is one of the examples we did for ARM support in Hadoop. Like that, we have supported like colleagues from Open Lab Testing and Huawei, and many other folks in open source. So we have been supporting other big data projects as well, like Hive, Spark. All those things are now supporting ARM, and CA has been added for all those projects. As I mentioned, the compression codecs are we have seen bottlenecks in compression codecs in ARM. Maybe we need to contribute here as well to make the performance in ARM better, and we might get the better performance in ARM cluster. So with this, I would like to thank entire community for all the support given for this work, especially Stu Lauren, Anu Engineer, Dio Zhang. Stu Lauren helped me to verify all these upgrades. Like once we upgrade the Hadoop, how it affects the other components like Spark. Our big data components, he helped us and he found out some issues. Thanks to that, Anu Engineer, Dio Zhang really helped us to come up with a few patches related to this, Akira, Stack. Many people helped in review all these contributions. Stack, Tsuyoshi Wazawa, Vichu Chang. And so Zenyu Zheng, Liu Sheng, Chandru, Brahma Reddy, Vadraj are all our colleagues from Huawei who has helped us to contribute patches, have discussions internally for about this, and make us provide for ARM in Hadoop. And I Saxena is right now using Cloudera, and he was part of Huawei before, and he is the one who helped in all this previous performance test. Thanks, Ayush. So at this, we came to the end. If any questions, I can take up now. Thank you, Ganesh. Thanks, Brahma. Thanks for your support. Thanks, Ayush. Thank you, Akira. Thanks for your support. I think we have one more minute. Yeah, sure, Ganesh, we'll discuss about it. Okay, it's time up. Thank you guys. Have a good day.